Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We are getting game two underway in just a moment. And Fnatic, well, their loss to Royal Club in the semi-finals at Worlds last year hit the team hard. But with the addition of Reckless to the roster this year, the team feels stronger than ever and believe their first step to victory at 2014 World Championships is securing first place here today.
We are into our first semi-final matchup. It is going to be Fnatic versus Royal, game one in this best of five.
I had a feeling that last year we could even perform better, and I was kind of disappointed.
We looked decent, but I don't think it was our strongest form. I just remember I was watching it, and man, I'm like, just man, if we just didn't do this, or if we did this, we would have won this game, so.
Fnatic have to back out of this fight. Yellow starts taking that damage. Aston holding so much. Peke comes in, gets on one
way. Whoa, Peke goes down in a second.
Like, there were four games. I think I have watched them 10 times. It's a bit hard because you see all those mistakes, and some of them are really simple stuff that could change so much in the game.
It's not like they completely stomped us. It was just some mistakes we made, and they made less mistakes, so that's why they won. I didn't expect to get so far, but when we lost, I was still a bit disappointed that we could have made it to the finals if we just played a bit better.
Compared to last season, I feel like all the teams are improving, so we are also improving.
I think fresh blood to the roster is always good, especially Reckless, since he's really hungry for victories.
Sort of my whole mentality is to play as much as possible so I can perform on that highest level possible and also achieve as much as possible. But at the same time, I'm just a person, I'm a human being, I can't expect too much from myself either, because then I will just lock my gameplay and I won't be able to do anything. So I'm just trying to keep my feet on the ground, pretty much.
He knows himself that he really wants to perform and he wants to improve day after day, and that's why he plays so much. And I think it's helping us as well.
We just have good atmosphere and like good attitude towards the game. And even though we have our down times, we usually manage to come back up at some point. I think we're really hungry for the first place. Like, we won all the splits so far, and I don't see why we should stop now.
In Fnatic, we have four players who have been playing for 4 years already. Playing after 4 years at the same level is so stressful.
It's impossible to play all the time for 4 years straight, so it's just you have to change sort of your mindset. When you can't play all the time anymore, you have to sort of find another, like, strength of yourself.
I realize we don't get that many chances to go to war. Like right now, even if we are at our best or something, we are not gonna play for 10 years or 15 years.
I feel like I still have some time to play the game, so I don't really think it's gonna be my last time at Worlds or something like this.
Even just dreaming about winning Worlds or something, that's like a great goal. So that's the reason why we have been staying so dedicated.
I want to compete, I want to be the best. And in anything I start, I want to finish. And I've told myself, like, my goal is to win one day the World Championship.
So I think every year I treat it as if it was the last one. Like, okay, I'm gonna give my best, try as hard as I can. That's the aim. Like, obviously I'm really happy with going and performing, but if I compare a lot, it would be super cool to do as good as last year or even better. And that's the aim I have pretty much every time.
And we'll see whether they can actually go one step further. No European team has yet to reach the World Championships. They got close, of course. Froggen and Wicked have also been close, both got third place. Do you think they can go one step further?
Well, they did win in season one, which helps. Well, but
it's kind of a different thing back then.
If you do look at some of the recent seasons, Fnatic as a team, Reckless was a great addition, as long as they learn how to play with him. They still, sometimes you feel like they focus too much on him as the guy who's supposed to care. Like, whenever they pick Vayne, we see everyone from Fnatic just put full focus on him. And if it backfires, well, they have nothing left. Like, there's no plan B in the game. So They just have to figure it out because they do have some great players. They've been playing for so many years, they have experience, they have the talent.
Let's see if we get any changes here from Champion Select. And that question already answered as Twisted Fate is banned out by Fnatic. With Ahri and Twitch again though, Cogmore will be removed from Alliance here. Kassadin got through.
So this is basically Alliance leaving Kassadin open, hoping Fnatic will pick it, and then they can go Tristana mid lane for Froggen, like he did against SK Gaming in the semi-final. Take away the AD carry as well from Reckless. And I wonder then what we're gonna see from Taps, if it's gonna be Tristana mid lane. It's just an option, but it's pretty clear here. They leave Kassadin open, so they could take Tristana in first rotation, and possibly Nami.
Well, that's... It was a risky play before. Of course, they had Cogmore alongside Tristana. Very, very risky. We heard from Taps, of course, as well, in the interview after that game. He said, well, that was just adapted on the fly. They may well have to do that now. Will they go for that Maokai in the top lane? I wonder if they're going to try and gift that one across to Wicked. We did see Soaz in it last time, and you know what you said, the Fnatic. They don't want to take that as their first pick. That's why they went Kassadin.
Yeah, and we just have to see what Alliance response. I mean, this is going to tell us a lot about how Alliance look like the likes of Maokai and Nami and potentially even a third AD carry, because they have pretty much everything open in terms of supports and in terms of tanky top laners. And it seems like they actually don't want to take either of them and want to see what Fnatic is going to lock in first before they respond. I mean, we still have to remember, it can be Tristana mid lane for Froggen here.
Yep.
Could also go into the AD carry role, and Fnatic have got to kind of pick around this now with almost questioning themselves, where is that going to go? Will he do it like we saw yesterday? Do we now pick our AD carry, or do we leave that and see still? So questions and a few mind games here coming into this one. And it looks like Fnatic are going to say, you know what, Tristana mid lane or in the AD carry role, let's just take our bottom lane and be happy with it. Lucian and Nami.
One thing we shouldn't discount, we have seen Kassadin in top lane. So as
true,
could well be one of those players to pull something crazy out.
Well, so Lucian, Nami, they do take the Nami, which should mean the Morgana pick will be risky on the side of Valenti, unless they want to go for the lane swap this time around and avoid the laning phase against the Nami here. Otherwise, Braum could be an option against Nami once again. It is a bit of a tricky lane. You can get out of it. And then it's all about the teamfights where you have your ulti to block the and actually completely remove the Tide Wave from Nami. And also works well against Lucian and he's calling. But Reckless used to always build Blade of the Ring King and Ghost Blade on Lucian here. I wonder if he's going to do the same and try and once again look for these picks in the side lanes and not necessarily straight up team fights.
Well, he's currently dancing around a bunch of picks, hovered over a lot of AD carries, but not going to select one. So he's keeping Fnatic guessing. He's like, we're going to go double AD, or are we? We're just not too sure.
So when they're Fnatic, or sorry, when Alliance played double AD against SK Gaming, they had Sugar and Lee Sin, they had Niff on Braum, because again, double AD, you auto attack very, very fast. So when he puts his passive on one target, instantly this target is going to get stomped by the 280 carries. And also you have this front line now of Lee Sin, a Bruiser, you have Maokai the tank, you have Braum the tank. So it's the same setup here. If they do lock in an 80 carry for Taps, we're going to see double 80 carry once again then for Alliance. Let's see what they pick. Because they go like Orianna in the mid lane if they want to for Froggen instead.
So we did see Swain then in the top lane for Soaz in game number two actually of that match against Rocket in the semi-finals. We already know it that Soaz can just play seemingly everything, so should never be surprised as to what he brings out. The real question is, does that Tristana land in the hands of Tabs now, or will it be Froggen? And then what is Tabs actually going to be playing in this one? Up against a Kassadin in the mid lane. The lane matchup for the AD carry, of course, will be against Lucian Nami, if they want to stick it. Two or two versus two, and it is going to be Jinx coming in, so we will see that double AD setup.
Yeah, double AD here. Some tricky lanes, though, for Alliance, especially also with the Swain one-on-one at the top lane. I mean, Swain is a great champion if he gets his standard lane, but if you do lane swap on him, he can fall very far behind because he's not very good at farming the jungle. So we could definitely see Alliance here focus on getting the lane swap early on. Also, dodge around his Nami Lucian lane. Lucian is not as strong in the lane phase due to his shorter range as we used to see, but he's still very, very good. He's the same kind of, he's good all around. He's very safe. You can build multiple different items. Of course you can build different items. I mean, there's different ways you can build them. You can build them for like the one-on-one potential with the Blade and Ghost Blade, the mid-game power spike, or you can build them full late game still. But double AD from Alliance, as expected, once we saw the Kassadin, Tristana mid lane, it's gonna be very, very easy lane for Frog, and they're going to put a lot of pressure on Xpector.
Yeah, for those that just tuned in and maybe haven't seen any of Gamescom so far, we did see this from Alliance against SK Gaming, and it did prove successful. It was their third and final match, which they won. Of course, the game number four of SK, if you want to check it out. Different plan here, though. They're up against Peke and not Jezzers. We'll see how that works out. Top lane advantage. Well, some say Swain is stronger than Maokai as well. So
it's a tricky
lane phase, whereas if you look towards SK, they were caught off guard. Fnatic will have known this was coming.
Yeah, I mean, as soon as they locked in Kassadin and Tristana was open, it's pretty obvious, okay, they do have the option of going to double AD carry. And then Braum coming in against the Nami and Lucian for the teamfights where you can block both ulties pretty much just as a support, which is pretty strong in these fights here. But I would expect the Lions to go for the lane swaps. If they do manage to get it, we have to see who actually plays the best, because in the last game, the Lions managed to do really well in the lane swap.
And there we see the trophy just out of our reach there, down there. But that's what these teams are fighting for. And let's not forget the number one seed of Worlds, which means you go into the top pool and avoid the top seeds out of other key regions. That's a really important thing here for Worlds.
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Game number two underway in front of a packed Gamescom. They are very much queuing out the doors right now, trying to get in here. Fnatic, one game down, starting out as the blue team up against Alliance, who currently lead 1-0. Unorthodox style, double AD comp, heading all the way back to season one, which Fnatic will have played in and won, remember. So as... Oh, Sapling's going to be leveled up first for Wicked. That will actually slow him down, but he's going to get away from this one.
But just notice Alliance, they're instantly moving all five members into the jungle of Fnatic. They're going to run down, place a ward between the two towers in the top lane to try and spot if Fnatic is recalling with their dual lane and sending them to the top side, or if the top lane is, there's the ward from Niff. So full focus, getting the deep ward here from Alliance, looking to spot out where Fnatic is sending their dual lane, and then potentially swap around it. I mean, Wicked did start with Flask here to either help him out in the jungle or give him some more sustain in a possible one-on-one. That's smart play.
Smart play. Throw the sapling into that side. Nice little sidestep there. That would have been really bad for him if that Q would have connected. I would have expected if the Q lands, then he would have instantly just flashed back towards the rest of his team there. Close little start here, an interesting one. Obviously, Fnatic now have the idea that Alliance have gone down there and warded up very early on. It doesn't really matter for them. Soaz is already in the top lane at this point.
It's interesting to me because remember when Alliance ran this before, it was SK that were doing a hell of a lot of lane swapping, trying to get out of this situation. They have that vision, they have those deep wards, they want to see whether it's going to be the Maokai Swain. But with Niff up the top, it's actually going to be sneaky. Three members hiding in the bush.
Exactly the same mind games here from Alliance. Wicked shows himself, so Fnatic believes, okay, it's gonna be Wicked top lane. And now they're already pushing down this bottom lane, so they know it's gonna be the lane swap, and now they can start being aggressive. Source just cleared the minions. So both teams, of course, have the timer. Pretty standard to have the timer just by knowing, okay, 7 minutes, I believe it's 20 seconds. And it's gonna spawn the second blue buff, depending on how fast you actually kill the first one here. So we do get lane swap. T-boards from Alliance paid off. The small mind games once again with Wicked. And, everyone moving towards this blue buff now.
Could be interesting. Yellow Star is getting in position, not got a ward to actually put down there. So he's kind of doing this blind. There is Wicked seeing Soaz off of the side. They don't know what they do now that Cyanide is there as well. What are they going to do? Braum is coming in as well. And it looks like they've done enough to force them away. This is very risky stuff at these early levels. Everyone's so very squishy. Not got their full complement of strategies either. Both smites are actually up here, so we may just see a smite battle coming in for this blue buff. What are they gonna do? Reckless now joins, and that'll force Niff back a little bit. Chuck comes through, gets his smite, gets his blue buff as well.
And this was four members from Fnatic, because up in the top lane, Taps is just standing farming. This actually meant that Reckless lost some farm in the bottom lane because he had to be with his team, and they didn't even manage to get the blue buff.
So Tabs all on his own, farming away. Mid laners were farming as well. Froggen and Peke have had a little bit of a tit for tat in that mid lane. Quick exchanges between them. Peke making sure he uses that null sphere on him every single time he steps forward. Following with the shot to just burn down. Peke quickly shields it straight back up and stops that hit point melting. It's actually Peke that's coming out ahead. We'll see how the farm works out, because Froggen managed to build up a hefty lead over Jezzers in this lane. He was at 100 CS before Jez has hit 70, so we'll keep our eyes peeled on that one. Three members in the bottom. They're doing a reverse.
This is not good for Fnatic. Again, while Fnatic had the four members of the blue buff, the lane was actually pushing towards the Tower of Alliance, so it meant after the blue buff was taken by Shook, Wicked and Niff went down together like they did in the last game and picked up everything. They got all the farm there, 8 minion skills. They missed a few Wicked, but still got experience from all of them, while Source was forced to just stand in the lane. Level 1 still, being zoned away from these minions. Not going to get the last hit. We'll get the experience. There we go, he got experience for the two, but still, it's the same deal. Wicked comes to the tower, he gets all the farm picked up because the lane is pushing. Rekkles wasn't able to face it due to have to run away, and simply means a lot of farm for Wicked already.
And a lot of farm for Tabs as well in this top lane. See, Rekkles and Yellowstar have finally headed up there, but Tabs saw them coming, already deciding to back away from that one. And Yellowstar just trying to get as close to the tower as he can, see if Tabs is actually just leaving that one, and they should hold this lane in place now. Wicked's going to be recalling, which means that Tabs will come down to the bottom. We'll get these 2v1s.
Yeah, they keep swapping around here. They want to make sure Source is not 1-on-1 against Wicked. I want to send down the dual lane, trying to deny some farm again. Source will get a massive wave coming into his tower, and there's nobody to stop farming it other than himself and Sarnite, who's staying around. Niff is not exactly scary enough, even though he is pretty manly.
Yeah, so as absorbing a little bit of the experience there. I don't think that was too welcome. Rekkles, he's pushed that top tower in, and Wicked will be happy with that. He's going to come up, absorb some of it. It will stick around his tower. So just cautious though. He haven't got vision of that Tribus, so he's no idea where Cyanide is right now, which is why he's playing so scarily close on there. But look at this, the Dragon Steal from Alliance. Yeah. Fnatic, not even close to this one.
So this was again another bonus for Alliance by swapping around. Yes, okay. We did see a lot of farm being picked up by Source, but they could instantly run to the Dragon. They saw two members from Fnatic up in the top, and they would never be able to join. Source was standing on his own tower. So easy Dragon from Alliance, again in the lane swap by swapping around. And now, what a fast push is mid lane. There's no wave there for Xpeka unless you get close enough to the minions.
Two AD carries. You've got the jungler and the support there. Cyanide finally coming across here, but Fnatic need to be really careful as to how far out they push. They do manage to get rid of the wave, which is the important thing in this scenario. So I was actually TPing up to that top lane as well. Meanwhile, Wicked is TPing down bottom. Like, they're swapping all over the place.
Don't want to deal with each other here. I like their move though from Alliance, because they actually expected the swap back again, because Rekkles and Niff recalled, Rekkles and Yellowstone recalled from the top lane. So I expect them to be in the bottom lane. Therefore, they could just run by the mid lane, get some damage on the tower, and then go up to this top side here.
So Tabs back in the top lane, and he's continuing his farming. This is the merry dance continues. So as goes back to base, I think we're going to see another attempted lane switch. Who's coming out on top? I mean, this is a full-on back and forth. They are switching once again. So as is going to return, is it mind games? Are they going to try and stick around? Is he going to go? Look, he doesn't. He's waiting for. He's going to get a crit catalyst. Yeah, that's what he's waiting for. Now he's going to come to the top. His wave is shoved in. Actually, I'm not sure if Tabs wanted to do this. I think he was expecting the lane swap again.
Well, still, just by getting some damage on the towers when you do have a Jinx and you can fast push now. I mean, look at all the damage he's doing now. He got the top tower fairly low. He got the mid tower fairly low. It means Alliance can quickly rotate around on the map, get two quick towers, and they're definitely winning out on the lane swap again because they got the Dragon before. Wicked managed to pick up a lot of farm in these lanes here by swapping around as well. And now they can take a top tower, can go mid lane, get the mid tower as well, and then the next Dragon spawns and they can pick it up.
There was a tweet from Dyrus as well. It says that Alliance's pick plan phase is actually really, really strong. And so far, that proving to be true here, as they do manage to take that first tower. They're ahead in CS in the important lanes as well. Not that everything, not that supports aren't important. And, you know, sorry, Deficio. I know you'll get me later for that one. And it's actually 8-1 there. So technically, yeah. Technically, is ahead. And Froggen just pressuring constantly. Funny, actually, because I think Xperke was the first person to actually play an AD carry in the mid lane in the LCS, right in the very first game of the LCS against SK Gaming, where Ocelot played in Nivea in the mid lane.
Wow.
Someone's been watching some old games. Like the rest of us.
I like to watch it to see the time.
Uh-oh! Didn't want to jump there, that's for sure. Cyanide comes in, Niff to the rescue just in time. Blocks off the damage, but now he's in trouble maybe. The chompers go down, they're trying to dictate it. We haven't seen Froggen back away. Tabs is actually out of position. Niv's going to continue to get chased. Tabs can't get involved in this one. He now has to get away. Never move Nudes. He's got flash available, but they could just follow through. There's the force balls. Will slow him down, and he does get away. So first blood strikes, and it's actually Alliance that make the mistake. And would you believe Froggen sneakily came back around? They're going for Yellowstar. They're going to jump on him. I'm not too sure they've got the damage for this one, though. He should be safe, but I'm not so Shook will be. Whew, has to get away. Oh, Peke, not done yet. He may well get him. The choppers go down. Peke, he's in the between 280.
Get away, Shook.
He gets under Shook. Now he gets taken down. Well, I'm not sure they want me to breathe in this one, Joe.
Well, I was just watching with like big eyes at this because I didn't expect to fall through. My initial thought was that was pretty amazing and quick reaction from Shook, but Froggen, Peke doing exactly the same rift walk to flash, and now Niv in the mid lane is once again going to be pressured. Cyanide is not really doing much farming. He was doing big circles around the mid lane, keeps coming in and out to defend that one, and there's the rest of the team now coming in. Another ring around from Cyanide. Shook's also going to come straight down this mid lane.
The tragedy of that whole play is Soez has never moved, never actually landed. So he didn't even get an assist. He didn't get anything.
Poor guy.
That's what he wanted. He needed that assist, that gold. He shoved the top wave in. Tabs is going to gratefully accept that present and clear that wave out. While this is all happening, Wicked's off on his own. He's having a great time down the bottom right now, farming up a storm. So Alliance, while they are 2-1 down in kills, they are ahead in gold, and it's working well in their favorite lanes.
Still though, give up two early kills to a caster, and it's never really smart. I mean, next time Xpekka goes back, he can get the Rod of Ages completed fairly early on. And that's why Chase, even though there was a chance he actually died, he knew as long as he gets some kills early on here, he can be the guy to completely snowball out of control. So Chase Boyd got the two kills, ended up giving double buff to Taps, but he's just been sitting in an empty lane anyway. So the double buff really not been used, but he's going to come to this mid lane. Remember, the tower is still very, very low, and double AD carries can push him very fast.
Froggen just destroying those waves. Here comes Jinx. Only Peke there is going to force pulse the wave down, but with that takes a good chunk of damage as well, down to half, but I think he's actually held onto it, and there was Cyanide as well running in. And Cyanide again able to defend at least for now, but it's not going to last long with both Jinx and Tristana there.
Looking at the build from Frog, actually, he wants to go for the play of the Drain King, but let's just see what's going to happen here. Yellows are setting up, Tannerin coming in, and denied.
Denied, Cyanide goes in, they just hop back away, Teleport comes out. Wicked wants to join the party, that tower on next to no health, but they will fall back and hold. So Teleport not exactly used to great effect. We are going to see Soez head straight across, he's going to get a giant wave. But with the Dragon up in 10 seconds, it's Alliance with positional advantage.
And two ultis gone here from Fnatic. Cyanide and Yellows are both used it in the mid lane, trying to pick up some kills. Alliance setting up for this Dragon here. They want to take it. They have the timer up in his top lane. So once he is farming, but does have Teleport, so he can join in if needed.
Ward back over. Dragon already down to half HP. Fnatic are nowhere near this one. It's going to be another one for Alliance. Oh. There's the ultis coming out. Yellows are going to be the focus. Super Mega Death Rock, he comes through. It's Froggen that gets the kill. Also very, very low. Two more autos will actually stun him. The zap hits, that's gonna be it. Peke goes down, it's a double for Froggen, and they're gonna get the mid tower.
So in game one, Fnatic didn't want to contest any dragons if they felt like they were in a risky situation. This time around, two ultis are gone. Source wants to recall in the top lane, he's only sitting on a catalyst, and yet Fnatic actually went in for the fight. Source was teleporting at the ping ward you see down the bottom of your screen. That was so far away from the rest of the team, he would never be able to join in time. Insanely risky move by Fnatic here. They didn't stop the Dragon, gave up two kills and the mid tower here, completely backfired. And they didn't do this in game one. They would just give up the Dragon and say, fair enough, let's not take a chance.
I cast my mind back to last time these played in the LCS Summer Split when Alliance completely bullied Soez out of the game. All his positional movement did exactly the same thing. Still waiting to get that Rod of Ages completed, but Wicked, you can see, it's a 20 CS advantage he has over him, along with that assist. Wicked's getting all the free time, while Soez, he's desperately fighting against this one. Well, and the rest of the team, they're starting to create plays, and Alliance now with two towers down, the third one surely will fall soon, as soon as the AD carries head down towards that bottom. At the moment though, it's a three-man defense versus a three-man attack in the top lane.
Shook is actually off doing Golem, so he would have been a little bit later to that party. Is now coming in there though, as Cyanide still, as far as I'm aware, has not been spotted. by Alliance. There he will be spotted now as he comes towards the turret range. Shot not shown himself either, though. There's a ward inside of the Tribush which would have given him away. He's sticking to the very top of the map. And now we see Yellow Star, Cyanide in particular, is just going to back away. So Shuck was just waiting there in case Cyanide did try anything. Didn't happen for him. They can actually get back. There is a sweeper on the Tribush to get rid of that ward, but Shuck's not going to follow through. It doesn't matter. They're recalling anyway.
And none of the carries from Alliance are actually going for static shift first items. Not really looking to just fast push down these lanes and go instantly for even more towers. Instead, we see Blade of the King for Froggen. And that's a bit special. Normally we see like static shift, we see Infinity Edge, but I actually really like Blade against Swain because Swain has no gap closer. Same actually goes for Cyanide here on Evelynn. Of course, he can kind of cleanse their own slow there, but there's no gap closer on Swain. And the issue for him is always, if you want to try and kill the back line, you kind of have to run in their face, so you have to have flash ready. When there's a Blade to slow you down and speed up the AD carry, it's going to become even harder for Swords to ever get towards the back line. And then it's suddenly all about Cyanide flanking around and Xpekka jumping in alone, and then the two AD carries with Braum helping them can instantly take down these targets fairly easily.
It's a good mix as well, because Tabs went for the IN, so he's going to have that now completed. Static Shift, we're going to be coming out of him shortly. So good mix between these two. Froggen burning through. His CS is climbing. I saw him taking the Wraiths earlier on as well, so they're giving Froggen absolutely everything. Top lane turret, that's going to fall. Niff's not going to be able to defend this one. Fnatic will get themselves their second of the game. Kullian being used to just burn out the wave. Tabs is waiting to receive the rest of those minions. Look at this though, Cyanide, he's trying to set up for a kill on Wicked, who is actually trying to shove out. Wait, they're going for it.
Oh, Wicked down at half and can't see him escaping this. Cyanide moving in there. It's going to be finished off. It's Soaz that actually gets the last
hit, but
he's not finished here. TP's actually coming in there with a kick on towards Cyanide. Can they chase on through? Peke was having a look for that one. They're not going to get any more there, and they've got no real deep vision here either, which means that Fnatic are likely just going to back away from things. Soaz, oh, they're waiting there. They're setting up a trap. Ah. And it's all foiled by a single ward over the top.
Yeah, so Wicked actually wanted to set up the game because Froggen was running from the mid lane and Shuck was running from the jungle, but he didn't know Cyanide was there, so he just went too far away from his team, went a bit too early, ended up dying for it. Now onto this mid lane. Remember, no static shift for the AD carries, so they don't have their insane wave there just yet. You can have for both Jinx and Tristana. The Blade will make Froggen stronger in the early mid game, which also could be one of the reasons he built it, and then you have Tabs going for the late game build, and you get some power from the Blade from Froggen. I don't know the math behind it, if it's actually more effective in terms of the damage he can do. We're going to have to see how it's going to work out when they do have to kill these late game tanks.
I think it's also one of the better ways to get away from a chasing Kassadin as well. Use your Blade first, ulti him back, and then rocket jump away, so you give like a maximum range there with the movement speed as well once you actually hit the ground. So either way, we'll see about that one. Oh, there is Peke jumping in. Reckless there with him, but Niff, as is the strength of Braum, as soon as he starts getting a little bit tanky with his Unbreakable, it's so hard to get past him.
But we also see what Alliance is doing here. They're actually using the Blade to make Froggen now a split pusher, looking for one-on-one. So they send him to the bottom lane. They had Wicked in the top lane, pushing down every single lane. Don't want to overextend, not going to move into the tower because they have no deep wards to spot Fnatic moving around their own jungle. So the Blade here made Froggen stronger in the early mid game, makes him a bit of a split pusher, and it works really well against Swain because you can kite him around, which is the weakness of the otherwise lovely Birdman, or one of the weaknesses. Another one is healing reduction, which Tristana, funny enough, also brings.
Well, if we were to get to the really late game, what exactly is going to stop Wicked? There's nothing going to be able to burn him down quick enough, surely, from Fnatic's side. I mean, Reckless can get on him, but you've got to worry about these two AD carries at the side.
That's a very good point, and one of the reasons to come from Alliance is so strong, and why Dyrus was saying Alliance has a really good pick and ban phase. The fact you can leave Kassadin open and still feel like you get two good options, two good choices, and how do we want to counter this Kassadin, just means you have some good options in terms of comp. And still, playing double AP is very different compared to playing like an AP mage, because you have to be a lot more careful and you have to kite around in these team fights. And if you get flanked right, you need some very, very good wards, because if you do get flanked, your backline will die very, very fast. But let's see what happens here. Four members of Fnatic, Source joining in as well. Around this dragon, they do have the mid position, so can push the mid tower like Source is doing now, and Alliance won't be able to defend it.
Oh, there is the slows coming in. Peke gets hit with a Zap Frog and then gets a couple of auto attacks off. The TP comes in to the Death Brush, and Alliance have all five men there. They may give up an outer middle turret for that one, though. That's already going down pretty quickly. Dragon is now finished off. Fnatic will get the tower, so that's the trade. But can they get out alive from this one? Yellow Star needs to be a little bit careful. Soaz actually getting slowed down the top. There is a flank. Cyanide coming in from the backside, but he's going to be focused down. Shook will get that kill. Then it's on to Peke. Good call in from Reckless as he goes backwards. A double bubble as well. Should stop most of the chase. A never move comes in. Peke gets it. They turn it around. Fnatic are going back in. The flash is away from Tux and Nip. Yellow Star will get the slow. And there is Peke going back in again. Tav did get another one before now, surely going down to Reckless. There is a straight up. It's a triple kill for Reckless. Leasing their walks away on the top side. But for how long?
So in the very, very start of the fight, Alliance actually managed to get a kill on Sana. Then they chase in. And instantly, one very, very nice Nevermore from Soaz and Pink when they're now going for Shook.
Well, Shook's not going to get away from this one. Or is he going to turn it down?
Wow!
I'm not sure who surprised who in that one. I think Peke was like, I'll get my blue. Whoa, no, I won't. But it's going to be a mid turret nonetheless. And Fnatic, they have the advantage. Cyanide! No! Pink Ward went down. Wasn't quite in time.
Still though here, Fnatic managed to push up the tower. Let's see it again. So Sana's actually flanking around. If we talk about how if you don't get a vision of them, they can flank them. He's not strong enough yet to do anything, and Peke is not able to join him. Same goes for Soaz here. So in this start, it's looking good for Alliance. They keep chasing now. Pay attention to Soaz and his Nevermore coming in. And as soon as Peke sees it, he knows it's gonna hit. And he just jumps in. He knows he can one-shot Frog at this point, kills him, and now Fnatic can chase. Casted in one of the best champions in the game and just continually chase, land another slow. We do get a return kill from Alliance, but in the end, Fnatic and Reckless can clean it up. Soaz had teleported behind them. He's walking in, hello.
Well, the focus was the double AD comp of Froggen and Tabs. Let's not forget about Reckless, this cheeky move.
He's gonna kill him in the end with the red buff. Smack.
You're burning.
Way, not gonna work.
So, triple kill for Reckless, that's going to give him a big advantage. He's now got the Infinity Edge and the Zeal well in the way. Static Shift almost complete, but Alliance, they're going to get themselves this turret. But look at the mid lane. It is just Froggen holding out against three members of Fnatic pushing in. He's got the Static Shift complete. If he had to clear the wave, got to dodge out of that bubble. Peke might go deep on this one. He's going to go aggressive. They're getting the damage on towards the turret. They finally back away. That's the half the hit points taken off the middle turret. But now look at the bottom. Taps is left alone. The AD carry burning it down. Soaz has to follow. The rest of the team will rotate. But look at Fnatic. They're back up to the top lane. Everybody counterplaying everybody else.
And they should be able to get some good damage onto this one. It will be 4 versus 4 up there. Peke obviously already used his teleport, so he couldn't join in either way. Fnatic decided to back away from it. Done enough work there, it seems. And look at the gold here, something we've not really talked about for a while. It's still close. 1,200 the difference. Alliance with the lead on that front. Basically the dragons that they've been doing so well off.
Got all the dragons early on here. Still though, we had Fnatic first mid lane and then went straight to the top lane as soon as they saw Jinx down this bottom lane, tried to push it in. Didn't actually happen. Alliance managed to defend. Same goes for Fnatic in the bottom lane. I should probably correct myself from before as well. It's called Never Move, not Never More. That's pretty embarrassing because I used to play a lot of Swain.
Not very well, clearly.
Well, you don't have to read the ability names.
Hey, I know your record on him. Big plays coming in. Cyanide deep into the team. Shook bouncing them around. We knew what he does on Lee Sin, and he does it again. Soaz gets locked up there. They're going to burn him down, but there's a lot of damage coming out from Reckless. He tries to chunk down, Shook the rest of the team back away. They turn it back onto Yellowstar. They're burning down. One more hit will do it. Wicked's the one that picks up the kill. The three members of Fnatic fall. Alliance move to Baron. It's dangerous, dangerous play with Reckless and Peke still alive.
So Peke was down the bottom lane farming. He wasn't there with the team, and Alliance, they saw an opening. They went straight for it. Beautiful engage. The Braum ulti as well from Nif was perfect. And then when you have these two AD carries staying in the back, they can just go half. Fnatic, though, they want to get this mid lane.
Think about recalling here someone from Alliance. It's actually Nip that started it. The rocket jump from Froggen will put him out, and he's actually looking to come in from behind them. Baron does get finished off. They're going to try and squeeze Fnatic in here. There's four of them come through the lane. Fnatic wisely heading towards the bottom side of the map. But look at this. There's a TP from Wicked. He's going down into the bottom side of the river. He'll be able to hold one of them down for long enough for one of them to get in there. Who's he going to go for? He goes for Reckless, who will use an instant flash, actually putting a lot of damage back. Nice. It's all going to be down to the Q from Shook. No chase going through. Fnatic get the inhibitor.
So they get the inhibitor turret here. Still lost the Baron and the fight. Let's see it again here. Expect is down his bottom and he's not able to join. Shook goes in. Fighting gets Wicked joins, and look at those here from Nif coming. So perfect. It blocks the entire entrance into this jungle. And then you have two AD carries now. Froggen and Tap standing in the backline. Nobody can get to them, so they can just deal all the damage. They're perfectly safe. You clean up the fight, you get the kills, you get the Baron. And honestly, if you do pick up three kills on a Baron, who cares about your mid lane with the turret?
That's just it. Braum is such a key component to this whole team comp. And yet he was picked up very late. That little sapling finally gets the touchdown. Frogger wanted the reset.
He just watered the plant, made it stronger.
Oh, God. So, double static shift, now picked up by Alliance. Dragon's going to get taken. Still, of course, the Baron on Alliance. They haven't shoved anything down yet. It's actually the top lane that's being pressured by Fnatic. Three, four members all moving that way. Wicked will clear this wave out, though. Swain trying to put the damage down for Soaz, but he's going to read another sapling. He can't put the pressure on. But when the four members get here, they may be able to.
Well, everyone is recalled from Atlantic, except for Froggen, who's still sitting down his bottom lane. So they want to try and wave there. We can also move up and just get the minions fairly low. And actually, Fnatic realizes, okay, let's not try it. They were waiting around in the jungle with all the wards from Fnatic here, hoping someone from Atlantic would maybe move in, potentially take a red buff. Just didn't happen. They were running base here, and Alliance in control for now. They can decide, do we want to use our double AD carry now to siege upper lane, push down these towers here, and force Fnatic now to engage. As long as Alliance ward the sides, especially with pink ward, so they can spot Sarnath flanking around, put a pink ward behind them as well, they should be able to avoid any dangerous engage from Fnatic, and then just push down these towers. I mean, look at the AD carries, there's so much attack speed on them, and attack damage.
We saw it in our last fight that Cyanide, the positioning was all good, but it was just not strong enough, and they just turn around and kind of focus him down until he couldn't really do a lot. That's a nice little defensive bubble out of Yellow Star. Will stop most of the damage coming the way of this turret. Wicked has also taken the long trek down from top lane, and that will leave Alliance with a five-man bunch underneath these towers. Can Fnatic hold on to it? This is a barrened up Alliance with a decent lead as well. Question is, can they break the defense? Not exactly masses of wave clear over for Fnatic, especially once that culling goes down. You see Nip actually blocking it and doesn't even finish off the full wave, which means the AD carries can get in, do a couple of hits on the turret, and go back and do it all over again and again and again.
And Braum is just such a good pick against both Nami and Lucian. You completely block the ulti. It's all invested onto the support here. And he just stands in there, takes all the hits while his AD carries are killing the tower. So keep doing it here. Gets a bit harder, gets a bit more risky now. And oh, Alliance might be in trouble. Never mind.
Never move catches, but nothing followed. Look at Cyanide. Wants to flank around. This is a risky play, though. Nif blocking out the damage again.
Source.
Alliance,
oh.
They just bought time. They're just churning down the inhibitor turret. Nobody's getting close to them. The double AD comp is working wonders right now. So has taken down. The rocket fires through. Now we see Cyanide trying to flank on. Low hit points for all of Alliance. Fnatic could potentially clean up here. The Aqua Prison does land. Taps is the focus. Beckett gets on towards him. Reckless picks up the kill, but he's quickly shut back down. Yellowstar, he's going to drop. This is going to be the inhibitor turret. It's a double kill for Froggen, and the inhib will fall. They can keep pushing.
They're going to keep pushing as well. Four versus just two men, Cyanide and Reckless, who've gone back, will be healing up here. Wicked, actually, a half HP, can tank these turrets, as can Nip if they really need to. There is once again the Cullen, being blocked out mostly by the Unbreakable. But it looks like Alliance have had enough of this one for now. They still have inner turrets in the top and bottom lane. Bottom
lane is chasing. There's a ward they can teleport to if they want to.
I'm not sure that they're strong enough, though, even with those couple of low men. Cyanide's at half. Reckless, actually, going to be getting back up towards full. Doesn't have a Vamp Scepter, and Shook just steals the blue buff on his way out there. Nice little pickup on that. The top wave was pushing, but let's have a look at that fight once again and wait for the Nami tidal wave. You see Braum just blocking it all out again.
Again, completely blocked by Nefria. Source is taken very low. Shook actually jumps in and he just buys time for the AD carries to constantly hit the tower. Now the flank comes in from Cyanide here, but Xpekka is not able to join instantly, and Source is already dead. He cannot get to the back line. He can never get to the AD carries as Swain here. And once again from Nip, puts the ulti across the entrance or the way towards the AD carries of Alliance here, blocks them off. Yes, okay, they do lose one member, but they've already won the fight. They get the tower here. And Shook did actually the same against SK Gaming when he had double AD carry. He just went straight under the tower, bought time for him to constantly hit it, and they take it down so fast. I mean, you have Jinx, you have Tristana, two of the best AD carries at actually killing these towers.
Wards all get replaced. Baron Buff had, of course, run out for Alliance. That's back up in 1.5 minutes, and it's Alliance with gigantic vision control over that area of the map. Froggen's going to shove the top wave down. That's going to be forced pressure on towards that inner turret, which could indeed be on objective themselves. The rest of Fnatic are hovering around position. They know they've got a minute to go in, but they have to group. They have to move on force. They rotate and protect that top turret, the inner turret, and they may get caught out in the jungle. Nif on his own, but he's a fairly tanky member on support right now, and he's got the support of his team.
You just have to remember, when you run double AD, the enemy team is going to stack a lot of armor. So late game, when you have this double AD as pretty much the only damage and all the armor on the side of Fnatic, it becomes harder and harder to pick up the kills, at least fast in the fight. They're going to need longer team for them to take them down. So Alliance just looking to keep up the pressure here. Wave comes in. This time around, it wasn't blocked.
Oh, they're going to go towards Shook as well. He will take the initial damage. But here comes the TP. Sawaz up the front. He's not getting the healing that he needs. Super Mega Death Rock. He comes through. Fine Cyanide gets locked up as well. And that's going to be two for Alliance. Wicked tanked up the turret there. And that is also, look at the super minions in the base. There's two of them hammering on the turret. They need to back away. Pekka goes low. He will be forced to retreat. They've locked one Nexus turret already.
They're going to lose the second as well. There's no way. Finally getting back. Reckless tries to burn it down. He just about draws the attention of the minions. The Aqua Prison actually being used, but the inhibitors now will fall as the rest of Alliance follow on through with the minion wave. They've got the hit points. They've got the death timers, and they're just going to back away. Froggen still fancies it. He goes forward. The rest of his team back away. Baron is up. They're going straight to it.
Straight to there. Teleport for Source here, so it might be the chance for Fnatic.
Oh, Froggen!
Can he get a kill? Yep. Okay.
And that's really bad news now, because it means they can't chase really towards Baron. The Nexus turret's going down. One more hit will do it. There is the second Nexus turret going down. We see Fnatic have actually just gone to the mid lane to push the last waves out there. But Alliance here going to take down this Baron. And with that, with no Nexus turrets, surely we'll be able to get in there and finish.
They should have one more team fight here for Alliance. They're going to go back, spend all the gold they just earned, and straight into the base of Fnatic, forced the very last team fight here. And you can just see Fnatic, I mean, they're getting all these armor items, but they just don't have time to get enough, because Fnatic, they fell behind again. Alliance have been just controlling the game. Early game was fairly even, but then Alliance took full control, won the team fights, pushing it down, and just been using this double AD carry and of course the Braum pick to win the fights, get the towers down. It hurts Source so much, the fact he can't buy an early hourglass because he had to get the Frozen Heart, or someone had to get it on the team. And when you don't have an hourglass on Swain, once you go in and you get healing reduction on you, you can't pop the hourglass and wait it out. You're just actually gonna die, which has been the deal for him. He's never been able to do anything. The Swain pick has been completely countered. Same goes for the Kassadin by the double AD from Alliance.
And it's been a very long time since that triple kill for Reckless. They haven't really won out anything since then, with an 11,000 gold differential between these two. Baron once again on Alliance. Fnatic, well, they wanted to try and sneak something here. They've got the bush ready and waiting. Soaz is waiting to pounce. I'm not sure if it's the right move. They're going to go for it anyway. Tries to get the slowdown and Shook. Froggen caught out around the side, but again, not really reading from the same page. Soaz kicked in. Can they turn the damage down on towards him? Nif blocks out all of the culling damage. Cyanide comes in with a great flank, but now he may well game down. Nif taken low. They do manage to get one, but it's a return kill. In fact, Cyanide goes down. Nif actually got away. That's not going to be catch on. Froggen bounced in the rocket jump, gets the reset. Will he chase on towards one? It will be Pekka. He gets the flash. Not quite the last shot. That's what he wanted. But the inhibitors are back up. The super minions are moving in. They're going for the base.
They're going to go for this one. Wicked dives into the back line. Gets Pekka. as well. There's still 280 carries now moving in towards the Nexus. Alliance want more kills though. There's a bubble at the end. It's a 5-5 mountain dive.
What?
Getting one. They're gonna know they don't get a second, but they are gonna finish off the game here. The 80 carries live, and Alliance go 2-0.
Second game in a row now where Alliance looks so strong in the chance. Like, they make it so hard for Fnatic, because if they do fall behind, we just saw it in this game here. There's nothing they can do against these AD carries. They needed Sana, they needed Expected to be strong so they could flank around them. They never got to the point. The Swain pick was completely countered. Braum being locked in for Nip, and suddenly Reckless and Yellowstar didn't have any ultis for any team fights. Alliance are just looking so good, and then lane swap again. Alliance are the ones, they come out ahead of the lane swap. Wicked was so far ahead compared to Source, and also farm on the AD carries.
We were just checking to see if the cameraman fell over.
I was right though, I thought he went over. I was looking to see if I could laugh, but no, he didn't. He saved it. So, 2-0, would you believe it, Alliance? And honestly, pulled out a completely different team comp. We saw it against SK, and again, it worked brilliantly.
It did. I mean, they have answers for everything. Fnatic wants to do, okay, we leave Cassidy in open, you first pick it, we don't care. We take Tristana, it wasn't banned by Fnatic. As soon as they saw Cassidy in open, felt like they had to go for it, even though they knew very high chance of double AD carry coming in here. Then they early picked the Nami, while Braum was being played by Alliance against SK Gaming in the exact same comp here. And as soon as the lane swap came in from Alliance, they dodged around the tricky lanes. They've got a lot of farm, especially Wicked picked up a lot of farm compared to Source. They got the first few dragons. Again, Fnatic is not able to contest these dragons at all. The one time they tried, ended up dying and also give up the dragon and mid tower. So they're just falling so far behind, and then they can't do anything against the comps from Alliance, who just have an answer for everything.
And I really like the fact that Cassidy is no longer seen as a 100% banny or lose type scenario. Yeah. Teams are kind of like using it as a bait to set up certain team compositions, counter plays in that mid lane as well, and that's a fantastic thing to see, because one single champion like Cassidy, we've seen it so many times, ban, that probably no one's been practicing that Cassidy so very heavily, and we've already seen it how many times this weekend at Gamescom where teams have left it open and they've gone, pick Cassidy.
And that's so like many times, though. Ban. So many times we hear teams go, we've got a counter to Cassidy. We've got a counter to Cassidy. So many times it's backfired, but this time it's worked twice in a row. But the thing is, everybody's seen that play now. Alliance have burned that tactic. Everybody know what is coming. So, what a great game, ladies and gentlemen. Game two goes to Alliance. They're now 2-0 up. Let's get over to Shox and the analyst desk for an in-depth look at another win for Alliance.
Thank you very much, D-Man. Well, Alliance is certainly on a mission here. And D-Man mentioned the plan is now out for Alliance with their double AD, yet the plan was already out, and it feels like Fnatic just didn't want to react to it.
Thing is, though, it's a plan. Yeah, sure. You know you can pick your Tristana into Cassidy. Have you practiced it? Have you played with an AD mid before? If you see what Alliance is doing these games, they're like map play. Suddenly Tabs will group up mid with Frog and push that tower. Those are things they've practiced and practiced well. Just because you know Tristana mid exists against the Cassidy doesn't mean you can do it, and that's what I like so much about this mind game in the picks and bans. They force Fnatic to pick Cassidy in, because what Alliance has as a counter, I don't think Fnatic has as a counter themselves. So they're pretty much forced to do something, and once the behavior is predictable, Alliance will exploit it.
I love the word usage, because what is great about the strategy Alliance employs, they go, you either pick Cassidy and we run our double AD comp, which we've proven can win, and we've got the playstyle to counter your Cassidy, or you don't pick Cassidy, give it to us, and hope and pray whatever your counter to Cassidy is works against us. I really think it's a very good mind game. I also think there was some questionable decisions. You know, something that was mentioned on the desk, the Braum was seen, it was let through to the second rotation there for Alliance. And I don't know if Fnatic should have picked that Braum up, if it's central to Alliance's playstyle or not, but the disengage from Nami, it just simply wasn't good enough. And if you contrast Yellowstar Nami's to Nif Nami, game one and two, day and night.
Yeah, absolutely. Nif was up here in the beginning of the show, and he is showing why he got that award as well. Fantastic play. And I got to commend the Alliance, because they've stepped up their both games at the same time, and they know if we get these picks, we know exactly what we're going to do, and they play well. How do you counter that?
You just have to play the game at the highest level. But I mean, like, if you look at both Nif and Shook right now, they're really the unsung heroes of Alliance, because they're the two roles that are not standardly and they're not
immobile, so they have to go around the map and pressure at the right points at the right times, and Shook is playing out of his mind. If you look at this composition, right, they don't have a hard engage. Like, yeah, the Maokai can dive in, but like, it wasn't even wicked engaging. Maokai was just peeling, and every time Shook would connect his Q, go in, flash kick, and it worked. And he did three or four of these engages, and it's incredibly hard to play with a double AD comp, by the way. We've tried it in the past, and if you overextend just a little bit, you'll get turned on. And I just like how Alliance is taking this match.
I would dare say the double AD comp hinges on Shook's level of performance. He buys so much time for the AD carries. He does so much work in the early game. He's living up to the praise and the hype that was attached to him at the beginning of the year, and he's really delivering.
Yeah, it's like the long con, because they used to ban out his Lee Sin in the beginning, then he didn't perform on it that well in the beginning of the split, and now everything else works for Alliance.
That's what I've been trying for a year now.
It's a very long con for you, Crepo. Let's actually take a look at one of the replays showcasing how good Alliance is in those team fights in the early game, going for the Dragon once again.
Yeah, I just wanted to highlight this replay because it indicates somewhat how this game is going. Fnatic has this ID. Okay, they're going, they're reacting. Fnatic's always reacting. Alliance is leading the dance, in this case, the dragon dance. But Fnatic is like, okay, how are we gonna counter this? Yeah, we'll TP behind them and flank him. And if we roll the clip, that's exactly what SOAS is doing right now. But Alliance doesn't give them time to wait. Niff goes in, their engages have been spot on. Niff has been engaging, Shook has been engaging, and SOAS, he can't even reach the fight. And that's the problem for now.
Yeah, full retreat. I mean, Fnatic may have felt they had more time, or they responded too late to it. I mean, Dragon was already killed before Soaz's teleport had even finished channeling. So, just misplays again, maybe some miscommunication on the side of Fnatic or Soaz getting in too late.
You guys mentioned Soaz as well. Would you have liked to see another pick? We saw the Swain working very well when they had the Syndra, they had the Never Move, and the other stun they could pick someone off. In this composition, maybe not?
I think it could have worked if you like see how they're playing. They had sometimes they had the right IDs, but just the wrong timing. We saw in middle as well, Cyanide flanked. I mean, if you manage to get flanks off with Eve, Swain goes in and wreaks havoc, and Alliance misplays one time, they'll die. We saw them get turned on in the mid lane one time, and they just got popped immediately. It is possible for Fnatic to win this comp, but not against an Alliance that's playing so well and has such good vision control early, because this is the second game in a row where lane swaps happen. Niff and Shook do better than Cyanide and Yellow Star, and the bottom control and Dragon control is always in Alliance's hands.
Also, they're doing very well with shutting down Reckless. Normally, he goes into the side lanes and he farms, but he's just not allowed to do that. Alliance is countering it very well.
Yeah, exactly. With the same thing, the roaming around, Reckless's Doublelift-esque playstyle of just farming up until the mid-late game and then becoming a monster just gets shut down because Alliance is not prioritizing these individual lanes. They're playing as a team and they're playing so well.
It just feels like there's no waste of time for Alliance. It really feels like from the moment they start their lane swaps, from the moment they start moving around the map, they are always gaining an advantage with every decision that they make. It's not simply we can do that to go even. We're doing that to gain an advantage, to get vision, to get control, to get objectives.
And it's making them confident. If we go back to the beginning of the game, we saw a blue buff being handed over to Alliance, 4 against 5, Reckless losing farm on bottom. That's actually, it's what makes League snowball-y. So Reckless moves over for the blue buff, the lane pushes away from him, he's losing farm. That in turn, when the blue buff actually got stolen to Alliance, allows Wicked to soak up that XP. The entire like shenanigans with the lane swap start from there, and once Alliance is in the lead, they keep making plays and forcing Fnatic to react, and just Fnatic can't keep up.
Yeah, and I gotta say, I fear for Fnatic on the red side in the pick and ban phase to turn it around in the next one. What do you guys think?
I completely agree. I think in both of the games, Alliance have come out with an advantage in the pick and ban phase. I think they've got what they wanted, and they're executing playstyle-wise in-game as well. So for me, Fnatic have to pull something out of left field, completely surprise Alliance, level up, and maybe they need to pull out a magic double AD comp that works for them.
I want to see Yellowstar on Thresh, honestly. I feel like we need some harder CC coming out of him, confident plays. I really want to see a 2 against 2 and 1 against 1, because I think it's proven in these both games that lane swap just will not work. And that's what I'm hoping for, because I want this series to go to 5 games, because they're pretty good to watch.
Yeah, they are. And for now, we're going to check in with you guys, because at the start of the show, we asked you to tell us which team in this series do you think will be crowned the Kings of Summer and why? And here's what you had to say. The first one is from @Shockblade. I think Froggen and Tabs will carry Alliance to a 3-1 victory. Tabs only died once in the series versus SK. True? I want to give some props to Niff too, though.
Oh, yes, I agree. I think the whole team is just really performing astoundingly. Froggen in particular has impressed me over the playoffs, playing different champions, playing different roles, and you know, aggressive and passive when he needs to be. He definitely wants to go to Worlds.
Yeah, the commentators always say how Tabs virtually goes untouched in these teamfights, but that's thanks to his teammates basically playing and saying, like, I will just die for you. Dying for your team is not a bad thing. Shook ends up dead in all these engages, but it'll kick somebody in the team, and the opposing member will just die even quicker, and then these double ADs, they go untouched, and they just kill everyone.
Yeah, they wreck Fnatic's day. The second one is from @JoeBurn. Sadly, as much as I want Fnatic to win, I think they make too many mistakes when they are in the lead and behind. I fully agree.
I think we've seen that. Yep. Case in point. Well played, dude. You got it right.
The third one is from @MattPD96. Reckless just got MVP. He's feeling great, confident, and that'll give Fnatic the boost they need to win versus Alliance. I'd like to turn it around. You say, well, it's the team that makes it happen. Even if you die, you make it work for the team. It's not enough if it's just one person and the team isn't there.
Yeah, but I think he's part of the team as well. You know, he needs to be at the right place. You can't fight 5v5 if your AD carry is splitting. That's not necessarily a bad thing, but you got to play around that. You got to know what you're doing, and Alliance is just quicker at figuring out what they're doing, and Fnatic is a little slow on the ball and reacting sometimes, but it's really hard when a game is this like fast-paced. It really shows who is the better team, as there's more actions going on all the time instead of just this one like massive, okay, let's group up for this team fight and I'll play it. So no, Alliance is constantly changing up the pace, and it's really nice to watch.
And quick decision-making. Fnatic have already shown multiple times their split. They do falter when under pressure, when things have to happen snappy, and now they do crack and fail, unfortunately.
Yep, and I dare say it would be a very good thing that they learned this lesson now and then not in a couple of months. Now, you can always stay in the conversation by tweeting @LOLEsports and using that hashtag LCS. We're dangerously low on mana, so we'll recall for 3.5 minutes. But game 3 begins when we return. Stay with us.
Nowhere near this one. It's going to be another one for Alliance. There's the ulti's coming out. Yellow side going to be the focus. Super Mega Death Rocky comes through.
Go on, Frank, have it. Nice shot.
We got go, 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 does land. Taps is the focus. Beckett gets on towards him. Reckless picks up the kill, but they quickly shut back down.
So as up the front, he's not getting the healing that he needs. Super Mega Death Rocky comes through. Finds Hainite, gets locked up as well. And that's going to be two for Alliance.
And it blocks out all of the cooling damage. Hainite comes in with a great flank, but now he may well game down. They've taken low. They do manage to get one.